Dragon Ball fans, welcome to Gamecast's definitive destination for all things Dragon Ball. I'm your host, Sully. Your second host is Mark. Do you feel better about that, Mark? That representation?
If people don't watch Pocket Edition, they'd be confused.
That's it. And as per usual, in, I believe, is issue 10 of G-Fighters, we'll be bringing you Dragon Ball news and movie discussion on the back end of this episode. Today, Mark, we have one singular piece of news, or more of a reveal to discuss this week. Trailer 3 for the upcoming Broly movie, which releases in December in Japan and January in the rest of the world. So, Mark, let's just jump straight into it. What did you think of this final trailer before the movie drops?
I thought it was like mostly solid trailer all the way around. Really cool. I want to see the trailer dubbed. We might get that soon. But it was just showcasing a lot of action and sort of some of the key set pieces that I think we'll be getting. This movie is going to be long and there's going to be a lot of changing scenes, it seems.
Yeah, I'd absolutely agree with that. One interesting takeaway from the trailer, though, is the reveal of, or in motion reveal at least, of Super Saiyan God Red Form Vegeta. So I thought that was really cool to see him in action. He looks absolutely lit as fuck. And another interesting pull away, which was actually backed up by an interview with the voice actor for Broly on the official Dragon Ball website, was that Broly is not a bad guy. He's not evil. So that's backed up in that interview with his comments on the character and a subbed piece of text from the trailer where Goku states that he senses no evil and that Broly is not a bad guy.
Yeah, I think one of the other characters in the trailer mentioned that he doesn't want to fight.
Yeah, and this, I guess, all plays in with the whole idea of fate brought them together, which seems to be the overarching tying factor for this movie. So, fabulous trailer, though. Really, really, really enjoyed it. I have enjoyed all of the previous trailers, but this is the trailer that I think I feel like we got that complete glimpse at the movie, because obviously the movie has only recently finished production. It's finished, right? To the best of our knowledge, it's finished because Funimation has a copy that they're dubbing. So I'm assuming that basically means the movies are, you know, in video game sense, gone gold, and now everybody else is dubbing it. So this trailer, I think, is representative of what the final product is going to look like in terms of CGI, animation, set pieces and locations. I think this is it. And I'm more or less was pretty blown away by it. Again, Super Saiyan Red, Vegeta looks awesome. All of it looks fantastic. A lot of the CGI I'm split on, however. The CGI... I think backdrops and effects, being the explosions, looked phenomenal. Like, holy cow. I think I actually mentioned it when I linked you the trailer, Mark, that scene where Broly's powering up and you've got that big rotating ball of green energy in that giant cavern or crater. Oh, that looked incredible.
It works well on effects.
Absolutely.
Not so much on the final frame in the... final frames in the trailer.
There was a couple of close-up shots and action shots. Like you said, that final frame in the trailer where Goku and Vegeta are charging up the joint power beams, obviously being the Gallic Gun and the Kamehameha, and the camera is panning around them as they're talking and charging, and it looks fucking terrible.
Yeah.
It's
not a good choice.
I mean, I've seen some people defending it, calling them in-between action shots. I don't see how that's the case. The characters are point-blank range in the camera, and none of the frames look good. They all look fucking terrible. Yeah. It looks like something out of a video game engine to me. That is the CGI of characters in this movie, which has, to date, been my biggest gripe with everything we've seen regarding the Broly movie, is the CGI on the characters themselves. The effects look phenomenal. They look fantastic. But every single time a character has been shown in a CGI version of themselves, it's looked bad. It's just looked bad. It's something to do with...
They don't look like they belong in the scene.
They don't.
That's the thing.
I can see them capturing the animation style with the CGI, but the line work of the characters on the faces and stuff looks incomplete or it's lacking. They look a little bit flat and porcelain. And it's just I think it's the line work, Mark. Like, it looks too light. In that last action shot of the movie with the joint power beam attack, Goku's mouth isn't even seemingly positioned correctly on his face. And then you still throw in all the kind of, in my opinion, it looks like kind of faint line work on their bodies. It just doesn't look right.
It's also a shame because when you see how silky smooth the rest of the animation in the trailer is,
yeah,
it makes CG seem like, why was that an option? Why did you choose that?
Oh, dude.
Because you're already going all out.
That's it.
Like Broly smashing Vegeta or Goku across the ice or the wall, like just like grinding his face. That looked great.
Well, that looks like something that Takahashi animated. There's a couple of close-ups on their face shots and that scene where he's being plowed through the ice. That Takahashi was like one of the most renowned super animators who worked on Super and especially shone through the Tournament of Power arc. He animated the Ultra Instinct incomplete reveal of Goku in episode, I think it was 110 or 111, which, you know, that episode stands above all else animation-wise. He flexes his skill and that style in the trailer. What he has on show in all three trailers looks phenomenal. But then that conflicts and the contrast between that and the CGI models is jarring. It's very, very jarring, which has always been our biggest concern with CGI and traditional animation, is how jarring those transitions can be. And when you have somebody as talented as Takahashi working on the movie, and when he really decides to flex up some of the close-ups or face shots and just, or in general, it's not good. It's not good. Like, I'm glad that we have kind of those really high peaks of detailed animation, but then when you drop all the way down to some of the bad CGI stuff, it's not good.
I feel like looking at it, they should have just hired Arc System Works, who did Dragon Ball FighterZ, just had them do that section.
I know.
Because that looks pixel perfect sort of thing. That would have blended beautifully.
Do you think the vast majority are going to have issues with the CGI that is going to be present in the movie? Or is it kind of just the extremists fans nitpicking it apart? I mean, don't get me wrong, and I'm assuming this is the same case for you, Mike. The majority of what I've seen for Dragon Ball Broly so far has been fantastic. I'm super hyped, and I think overall it's going to be a fantastic movie in terms of animation. However, I think it is going to be dragged down a little bit by these really glaring bad CGI moments.
See, I think it's a thing of when you see it, it's obvious compared to the rest. Like, it feels inconsistent, and that's why we dwell on it and things like that. But I've never been a huge fan of CG in anime, especially since it's consistently done pretty poorly. And when it's done amazingly, you barely notice it. And that's the issue. Like, when you notice it, you notice it hard. When you don't, you're like, okay, show's fine. So here, it's one of those things where we notice it because it's there and it lingers for a bit. Like, that final shot or whatever of Goku and Vegeta getting ready, that lingered for a bit. If it's just for a split second or something like that, it doesn't matter.
And a couple of weeks ago...
Still want to see Gogeta.
Dude, he'll probably all be CGI.
Better not be.
Do you remember, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago when we spoke about the CG team for the movie being given a lot of budget and a lot of leash? Do you think? Yeah,
it doesn't look... It looks like it for effects.
Seemingly, at least for the character models, not showing up on screen that we can see. And you'd assume they'd cherry-pick the best CGI moments for the trailer, so I wonder what the really bad shit looks like. Seemingly, though, perhaps they were given too much leash, and they bit off more than they could chew, and they've maybe failed to execute on a lot of it to the same quality that you'd expect, or the bar that the traditional animators have put in place. Just an interesting thought.
Mm.
We'll find out when the movie releases, I guess, in December or January for everybody else. Any final thoughts on the trailer, Mark?
I want to see Gogeta.
Oh, dude, there's no way that's going to get revealed in any more trailer or crap. I think that's the one secret that's not even really a secret, but I just don't think we're going to see it before the movie.
I feel like he's going to be revealed the exact same way they revealed Super Saiyan Blue, which is a tiny keychain that gets released just before the movie. And people were like, no, that's not what he looks like. He'd be like, nah, that is totally what he looks like.
I really, really hope not, but you're probably right. There will be like a... Actually, dude, wasn't there a Heroes card that we spoke about a few episodes ago?
Yeah, they didn't show it. It was Gogeta normal.
Okay, all right. Okay, yeah. But it was in the Broly series of super cards, wasn't it? Heroes cards. I think it was branded Broly. Yeah, all right. Well, there you go. We've already contradicted ourselves. So we've already seen Gogeta in base form. So anyway, let's move along, Mark. As per usual, we will be discussing a Dragon Ball movie in the second half of this issue of G-Fighters. So be sure to stick around after this brief musical break where we tackle Android 13. Welcome back, G-Fighters, to the movie segment of this issue. As I stated earlier, we are discussing Super Android 13. Mark, hit me with the Japanese title for this movie, though.
Oh, wait, I wasn't ready. I think it was the greatest battle. It was the climactic battle of the three great Super Saiyans.
Oh, I love it how every Japanese title is just the epic battle, the super fight to save the world, Saiyans 3 fight, etc., etc. It's always fighting in battles.
It was Extreme Battle.
Extreme Battle.
Because I think Climactic Battle was the Tree of Might.
Yeah, terrible movie. Anyway, Mark, I'm going to fire off some information regarding this movie. So the movie was released originally in Japan on 1992. It has a runtime of 46 minutes. It has an IMDb score of 7.2 out of 10. Seems to be a recurring theme, the scores, though. They all seem to be scoring around the sevens. It took home 2.35 billion Japanese yen at their box office, and that equates to 18.9 million USD. And the Western regions, or English-speaking regions, first received the dub in 2003. To summarize the story for you guys, though, the death of Dr. Gero at the hands of Android 17 and 18 promotes the activation of Androids 13, 14, and 15. They try to kill Goku, who fights them with the help of Trunks, Piccolo, Vegeta, Krillin, and unfortunately Gohan again. There you go, Mark. Take us away. What are your thoughts on the story for this film, Mark?
It's a recurring theme in the Dragon Ball movies now, where it's sort of like very brief setup and then straight action.
They've found the formula, haven't they? The movie formula.
Yeah. And like I said before with Cooler, I don't mind it so much because we have context for it. Like the second Cooler movie was we knew what happened in the first one. For this one, we know the android context and Goku's history with them. So you can kind of just go, oh yeah, there's more androids.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. But the actual setup before any action happens was one of the like more strange moments in their movies.
Yeah, kind of casual dilly-dallying. That's not even at all relevant. Just random setting. Although
and groups that don't make sense.
I found it kind of okay though. Like in terms of the story setup. Like obviously we have Roshi, Trunks, and Krillin, and I've forgotten the pig's name.
Oolong.
Don't know why I forgot his name. Oolong. Waiting for a beauty pageant. okay, that's whatever.
But it's, my thing was like, why is Trunks there?
Yeah, exactly. Why is Trunks there? Like, he just didn't want to go shopping with Goku and Chi-Chi, which is fair enough. So Goku and Chi-Chi and Gohan are all shopping. I don't know. I kind of enjoyed it. Like, obviously, we had in the series, they knew about androids 19 and 20, or they thought were 17 and 18 coming at the time, and they were just waiting for them up on the cliffs. I think it was at West City or something like that. This time, though, we're in the city just going about general day-to-day life business, and the androids just attack. So I'm kind of okay with how this movie opened up. At least, you know, it wasn't just they were camping or it was Christmas or, you know, they're just sitting around doing fuck all.
Yeah, they were dealing with some sort of daily life.
Yeah, exactly. So I was okay with how the movie opened, even if it were some odd choices with the beauty pageant. Australia got a mention, though, in the dub. So, represent. I don't know exactly know why or how it's relevant. Did you catch that, Mark?
No, what did they say?
Something about Oolong referencing Australia in terms of their beauty pageant or girls or something. And I was like, wait, is this movie set in Australia? I'm like, no, Dragon Ball's never set in real locations. But for some reason, Australia got mentioned in the dub. So if you know how or why, let us know down below. But to progress the story, though, Mark, like you said, it's the typical formula of Dragon Ball. Bad guy comes for one simplistic reason. In this case, we all know it's a Red Ribbon Dr. Gero reason. So hell-bent on destroying Goku. And then essentially this movie is one long giant battle. But let's talk about the battles and the fight scenes, Mark. In comparison to, I think, the previous movie, and what was one of the other weak ones? Can't remember off the top of my head. We've had a couple of weaker movies in terms of fight scenes. The Tree of Might, obviously, being one of them. Cooler's Return, I think, was relatively weak in terms of fight scenes. It was just kind of one Metacooler bombardment from Vegeta and Goku, then a bit of Ponage, then they managed to overcome him. This one had a lot of different fight scenes with a lot of different characters. So I enjoyed that a lot. What are your thoughts?
There were a lot of fight scenes, but not a lot of progress being made.
Touching on the progress, though, I felt like it's a recurring theme in the movies that the Saiyans never seem to reveal their true power until they've been pwned a little bit. This happened a lot in this movie. I was like, do you guys like being hurt?
Yeah.
Like, why haven't you gone Super Saiyan yet?
Yeah, Trunks was getting ragdolled around for a while.
And even Vegeta, like, I mean, yeah, it was pretty badass when he powered up to the Super Saiyan. And it's just like, you know, where's your smile gone, android, or something like that. And then he powers up and wrecks the little dude. But
what about Vegeta's entrance?
Oh, yeah.
It just breaks this iceberg and floats up.
And his reason for being there, I thought was funny as well. He's like, I just don't want Goku to die because I need to kill him.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably true and accurate to his character at that point in time. But I thought it was funny.
Yeah. What about Piccolo showing up in pretty much the exact same way as Vegeta?
Yeah. Piccolo always has cool entrances, though. Well, no, I immediately retract that because his entrances may be cool, but they're always to save Gohan.
Yeah.
Which I'm so over. I did notice, though, when I opened my box set this week, though, that the second piece of artwork on the disc, which is Bojack, Gohan's actually a teen. So thank God we're leaving child Gohan behind.
But it doesn't last long.
No, unfortunately.
But, like, at least Gohan takes a hit for Goku.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
About time.
Yeah, a lot of the individual fight scenes I really enjoyed, though, especially the stuff with Vegeta when he powered up. That was really cool. And the Goku underwater fight I really enjoyed as well, where he's just kind of being, like, brawled by, like, kind of, like, by this android underwater. Like, I thought that was really brutal and cool. I think nothing really stands out a lot to me in terms of the action, but there was a lot of it, and a lot of it was individual scenes between different characters. What really blew me away for the movie, though, is yes, I know, it's the same cliche formula that every Z movie's had. Goku powers up at the very end, defeats the enemy via a supercharged up punch from energy he's gathered from other fighters or a spirit bomb. However, I really liked the way they presented the traditional final moment in this film. One, Piccolo lifting up Super Android 13 at the end. I thought that was pretty badass
giving
of him.
Giving good old suplex.
Yeah, exactly. But the way that Goku went about defeating him, I really enjoyed. I feel like this is the first movie from memory where we got a proper spirit bomb on screen. Didn't actually use it. Absorbed it, because that's definitely safe. absorbed it, and then basically one hit killed him, which, again, there's nothing unique about that, but the way it was presented was, I thought, really badass. Like,
yeah, that he whole... He had like a death aura.
Yeah, right? And this huge swirling energy on the land, which just evaporated the land, and he was standing on this little pedestal left of rock and dirt, where he's, like, absorbed the bomb, and he looks like he's about to... Something bad's about to happen to him if he doesn't get rid of that energy. Like, he's got this crazy face on, and then he just... The animation in that final battle, I thought, was... It was presented really well, and it was fucking awesome. I really loved it.
Well, you can understand why he was pissed. He just got punched in the dick.
Oh, man. I love Abridged. So good. I didn't actually watch it this time, but I do remember that scene where he's being blasted through the canyons and Super Android 13 is, like, getting frustrated why he's not dying, and he gets that final blast where he lands in the water and he's just like, whee! Like, out of the cavern.
Yeah, and I just love it. The Abridged when he gets punched in the dick, and they just do a flash forward and do the Back to the Future thing.
Oh, man. So good. So good.
But he said that it takes them forever to go Super Saiyan.
Mm.
In the Abridged, they did that where, like, Vegeta remembered to go Super Saiyan and started thrashing, and then you hear Trunks' and Goku's inner voice go, "Oh yeah, Super Saiyan."
It's true though. Like, you know, it's the Abridged stuff is kind of freakishly takes the piss, but it's accurate on what we all think. So
yeah,
that's the best thing about that series.
Yeah. Well, what about Trunks trying to smack talk Android 13? Yeah. Because in my future there is no Android 13, which means that we defeat you. It gets wrecked.
Yeah. Oh, I love it. What did you think though, Mark, of the ending in terms of how it stacks up compared to the rest so far?
Do you mean the final hit or the fish jumping at the end?
Oh, I actually loved that. How good was that fish jumping at the end? It's not over. It's over.
You can tell they just dubbed that randomly.
Yeah, it's just like they just wanted to have a bit of fun, and they're just like, yeah, right, they're just going to do something silly for the credits. So
yeah.
But no, more
specific. Why was there a fish in the Antarctic like that?
I don't know. It'd be like a fish popsicle, right?
Yeah.
No, specifically the way it wrapped up with the climax of the story.
Yeah, it's one of the more, like, sort of brutal finishes that Goku has, mainly because it is a robot, so he can do the whole cartoon ultra-violence thing.
Yeah.
Which is cool. I liked his sort of anger aura, because it's probably one of the only times we get to see what an actual absorbed spirit bomb would do to his body and those around him. Because it wouldn't just be, like, safely put into his body, as we're all aware from Super. And some of the other times he's done it in some of the other movies. But here it had sort of, like, a presence more. It wasn't just, oh, yeah, it's in his body now. It's like, sort of, like, emanating from him.
You know what's interesting as well, another little interesting takeaway, was Krillin comments on Goku's purity, even as a Super Saiyan, because he's able to handle the Spirit Bomb as a Super Saiyan. But then he absorbs it, and he definitely looks fucked up. Like, is he still pure at that point? Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But anyway, any final thoughts on this one, Mark, before we wrap up Super Android 13?
I like how Android 13 changes so drastically in appearance.
Yeah.
Like, he wasn't just, like, jacked. He was like, no, I'm going to go blue. I'm going to turn into, like, Blanka from Street Fighter.
Yeah.
Just change some colors a bit. Get Vegeta's hairstyle.
It's that little bloody little purple dude that changes color so drastically, right? What I find interesting, though, is what would have happened if he didn't absorb the little guy. Like, he just absorbed that jacked dude. Like, he would have been huge. Like, if you think about those androids in terms of being, like, adding their genetics, right? If that little guy hadn't gone in to maybe equal out the difference in size a little bit, the dude would have been massive. My final thoughts, though, on this movie is I actually really liked, I think it was Android 13 in his original redneck form. I thought he was way cooler than the purple dude.
The red ribbon redneck?
Yeah, I thought he was way cooler, man. Like, way cooler. Like, I wish he'd just stayed that guy the whole time.
I like the effect on his energy ball.
Yeah, that was cool. That was cool. Kind of spirit bomb-y.
But, like, you sort of saw the core as the energy was coming.
The spirit bomb always reminds me of an egg. Like a yolk, and do you get that? Like, it's got the middle yolky bit and then the outside.
I always look at it like a sun.
Oh yeah, I could see that. I don't know, maybe I'm just the weird one. Anyway, Mark, give us your out of 7 Dragon Balls rating for Super Android 13.
I still really liked 13. I didn't like it as much as I remember liking it, but that's just like cutting hairs, like splitting hairs sort of thing. Like, I still really liked it. I think it's probably 5 out of 7.
Ooh.
Yeah, I think five out of seven.
Yeah. See, I haven't been able to decide yet. I've been tossing up between 5 or 5.5. Honestly, have no reason why I want to give it a 5.5. So, I think based on that, I'm going to stick with 5. I think that's actually one of my higher ratings overall. And again, I know I said this last episode, but I have lots of time this week and I have a reminder set. So, I'll definitely have a summary of ratings down below in the description box as of this episode. So, you can look at all of our ratings for previous movies. And I think Mark and I need a little bit of a refresher as well. All I know is highest... I think
we've had the same score for a little bit.
Yeah, I think we've mostly been hovering around the 4s to 4.5s to 5s for the last probably few movies. Our lowest being The Tree of Might, and my highest being The World's Strongest, which I believe was a perfect 7.
Yeah, you're going all out on that one.
That is still my favorite movie. To date. I'm not sure if anything's going to beat it, to be honest. I think that movie came at a time, you know, and I mean a physical point in time of the series where the story was unique, had good pacing, and the action and production value was quality. And we weren't at that point in the formula where everything was cliche either. So that movie, to me, I'm not sure anything's going to beat it.
Not even Bio Broly?
Absolutely not, Mark. Absolutely not. Oh. What's your highest been so far?
I'm not sure. It might be Cooler.
I think it might be as well. I think you have that might like be a cooler, 6.
Cooler or Lord Slug. Something like that. I think it might be Cooler.
Lord Slug was cool. All right, Mark. Well, let's wrap it up. So next week, guys, in issue, I think it's 11. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's 11 we're up to next week. We'll be discussing the BoJack movie, and we'll obviously be bringing you all of the Dragon Ball news that we find throughout the week. So be sure to join us next week for issue 11. As per usual, if you've enjoyed this video, please remember to rate, comment, and subscribe. Leave your thoughts and opinions down below regarding the Dragon Ball Trailer 3 and this movie. If you're listening to us on any of the popular podcasting platforms such as iTunes and SoundCloud, be sure to come over and check out our YouTube channel where we cover a variety of other content that doesn't make it to those platforms. But until issue 11, guys, have a good one.